Okay, so welcome to the summer 2021 Brownback Lunch Series at Lawrence Heritage State Park. My name is Richard Padover. I'm the summer historical tour interpreter or tour guide here at Lawrence Heritage State Park. And the Brownback Lunch program is something that I began here 2 years ago. And of course, we could not do it last year, and I brought it back this summer now. So I thank you all for coming today. Just a few announcements before I introduce the speaker. Just a reminder that we have free guided boat tours of the Merrimack River on Saturdays at 10 a.m. There are not that many spots left on the remaining boat rides, so if anybody is interested, they need to contact us as soon as possible. And as far as the Brown Bag lunch program, after today, we'll have two remaining ones for the summer. So next Wednesday, the title is April's Prominence in Socialism, presented by Tom Spitaleri, a historian who works at the Buttonwoods Museum in April. And then to close out the summer 2021 Brown Bag program, on August 25th, the title is The 14th Century Plague, 1918 Influenza and COVID. And that'll be presented by Dr. Stephen Russell, who is a colleague of mine at Northern Essex Community College, a history professor, and he will talk about the plague, the influenza, and COVID on August 25th. Okay. And the walking tours that we are still doing during the remaining time now this summer, the remaining weeks of summer, that's on the green flyer. So if you'd like information about my walking tours in the back of the room or downstairs in the lobby, the walking tours are spelled out on the green flyer. Okay. So basically Tuesdays, a walk to the Great Stone Dam. Thursdays, the Bread and Roses Strike walking tour, and then Fridays, the Monuments and Martyrs walking tour with Company O'Connor. And then, of course, Saturday mornings, the boat rides on the Merrimack River. So the walking tours all begin at 10 a.m. Just be here for 10 o'clock in the morning, and then we will head out. They last around 90 minutes or so, okay? And, of course, dress comfortably and appropriately. Okay, so so today now, our speaker is Bruce McBrien, and he lives and works in Amesbury. He's been a teacher for 24 years, and he's an instructional technologist and a local history and science enthusiast at an elementary school in Amesbury. He's very passionate about local history, and he works to get students more vested in the history of Amesbury and to help them understand the contributions made by those who came before them. So Amesbury has a new local history center, which is focused on the town's industrial history. As you may know, Lawrence, Lowell, places like that also have big industrial histories. And in Amesbury, where innovation and inspiration created change. And Bruce enjoys bringing the museum and its park and content to students. So Bruce is joining us today to talk about his local hero, George McNeill. And perhaps, you know, this is not someone you've heard of, but someone who has nonetheless made a huge impact in the world of labor and in primary education. And Bruce, our speaker today, did bring along a special guest, Roger, who is the great-great-great-great-grandson.
It's a long
of George McNeill. So, I am happy to have here with us today, Bruce, who will now take over the mic and give you a history lesson today on his hero. Okay, so Bruce.
And thank you for Bruce.
Yes.
Going.
Yes.
I just don't want you folks to get me confused with George McNeill. We have the same bald head here, you know, it's some other people in this room have the same thing. It'll take me a long time to grow one of these, but this is George McNeill, and not as a child.
And also, I'm sorry, one second, Bruce. And also, by the way, you probably all know by now, you've all been coming to the brown bag lunches, but there's a refreshment table there, so speakers and the audience, help yourself to anything you'd like. I did make a fresh pot of orange and spice iced tea this morning, no caffeine, so if you like some cold iced tea, there's cups there, help yourself. Right,
thank you.
Thank you
very much, and welcome. So glad you could join me. Roger is bringing around now some items just to pass around and take a peek at so you get a better sense of who George is. George was a remarkable individual. He stood up for an injustice as a youth, and that set the track for his whole life, which is, in my mind, a remarkable thing. It's something that I want to impart to my students. He worked for his whole life for labor fairness, and also for education, compulsory education for students, which was not existing. Worked all day, they didn't go to school. There were some attempts at it, like you Sunday school initially, whether or not it was not religious education, it was education. And they would, there was no other school else for these kids. Anyway, I want to give you some background information. George's hometown is Amesbury. And Amesbury is a town I didn't know about until I moved there 30 years ago, but I had since discovered that it is truly the heart of the Industrial Revolution for Merrimack Valley. It was founded in 1668. It's located in the Powell River, which is a tributary of Merrimack. It provides almost 100-foot drop between the river head and the sea in a mile. And that's significant. That's a no-brainer as part of the bill. The first sawmill was built in 1656. That was followed by a grist mill. The first fulling mill, which involved cloth, was established in 1708. And in 1710, an ironworks was erected. It would get a lot of iron out of the salt flats and convert it to usable iron, not great iron, but it was usable. And then larger woolen mills began to appear as more industry came to Amesbury. In 1720, the river also saw shipbuilding. The river is navigable, it's tidal up to the little falls, so they could build ships and then float them up to the sea. Is actually home of the first warship of the U.S. Navy, the Alliance, that was built on the shore of the Merrimack. What fascinates me about Amesbury is that it is such an incredible place for to put this adaptations and innovations. The number of them that came out of this tiny village are remarkable in my mind. I really do believe the seeds of the Merrimack Industrial Revolution started there in Amesbury. And I'll give you an example. Jacob Perkins, he was an innovator and inventor who came to Amesbury and patented and developed the first machine-made nail. So think about that for a second. You start first with making houses with pegs or trunnels. Then you could use hand-wrought nails. If you were a good blacksmith, you could make one nail in 90 seconds, roughly. So it take you, you might go to make maybe 1,000 nails a day. Take that fast forward to machine-made nail, you can make 1,000 a minute. So all of a sudden, Joe Everyman can obtain these nails. It just changes the building industry, and that was Amesbury. Another even more important name is Paul Moody. Paul Moody was the machinist that Perkins brought to Amesbury to build this nail-making machine. He then went on from Amesbury to help him establish the nail mill. He went to Waltham where he made these mill, if you know your history, one of the first textile mills. Then he was hired by Mr. Lowell, there's a name right here, Francis Cabot Lowell, where he developed a cam-operated power loom that could really amplify the scale of their production cloth. And that was Lowell. That technology obviously was used throughout Lowell and came here to Lawrence and to the large mills that developed in Amesbury. So it's a really kind of cool technological circle there. It's in those mills that our story begins. In 1847, 10-year-old George worked in the mills. He worked from 5 in the morning to 7 at night. The workers were allowed a 30-minute break for breakfast, a 15-minute luncheon privilege, and a 45-minute supper. There was another one that wasn't there. because of the increase in competition and the increase in production costs, they were looking for ways to make more money and share expenses. Well, the manager came in and he said, we don't need all those breaks. We're going to take 2 million breaks out. So the other mills were doing the same thing around the same time, but they gave their workers enough time. They grumbled about it, but they warned them it was coming. Derby didn't. Derby told them on a particular day, I believe it was, let me see my notes right here, on June, here we are, on June 1st, he told them that they will only get one break, midday break. Okay? So 100 men openly defied his orders, left for their customary morning break, and then were locked out. At that point, it was not technically a strike, they were locked out. But, and Derby fired them all instead. Interestingly enough, the women who worked there did not leave that day. They stayed, but on the following day, they struck in support of the lockout. So now you have bills that aren't working. Well, young George was outraged about this. At 13 years old now, he organized the kids in the mill against this action. And the local newspapers report that there were groups of children at the gate laughing and chanting, undoubtedly that would be a deal. And on June 3rd, he was charged with conspiring to start a riot. The local newspapers, which were pro-labor at the time, called it a trumped-up charge and said the youngsters were just milling around the gate with a few men who were causing trouble. There were just a few children acting jovially. I suspect it was really important. On June 15, 1852, the town meeting stood up in united protest against the Salisbury Corporation. The Salisbury Corporation owned the mills. To give you an idea, the Powell River now runs through the middle of Amesbury. At the time, it split the town. So the river to the sea was Salisbury, and from the river inland was Amesbury. So there were some weird things that happened in the late 1800s where they changed the town line. People going there because that's where I'm at. The town was so supportive of these strikers that they voted to expend a sum not exceeding $2,000 for these strikers' relief, which was remarkable. What's even more remarkable is that the towns of Salisbury and Lawrence also provided funds for the striking workers, which I think is pretty cool. The poet John Greenleaf Whittier spoke out in support of the workers, saying that over the past 3 years, the sense of community they had built around the mill, now dirt is destroying it, which is true. And George later said that the hours of labor that man must perform must not be left with a man whose only motive is to merge man and machine. Okay? This highlighted a quietly important truth that the workers considered themselves to be craftsmen, and the mill owners only saw them as a means to operate a machine. So two very different perspectives. And it showed that this new Merrimack Valley Industrial Revolution would not happen quietly. The striking workers tried to negotiate with Derby, but the police were brought in by the mill owners, and they hired 50 Irish immigrants to come in and take their place. The strikers never won their demands, they never got their jobs back, and the Derby strike today is considered by many to be one of, if not the first, labor action in America. It would be considered a failure had it not been for the fact that it set George on the course of his life's work. For the remainder of his life, he would be the center of every major effort on behalf of the working people of Massachusetts. That's pretty significant. At the end of the Civil War, the drive for improved working conditions gained momentum, but there were a couple of events, the Depression of 1868, another in 1873, that really derailed those efforts. And George said, empty stomachs, one can make no contracts, which is, makes sense. But he persevered, and that's another lesson that I take from my students. First, he believed in a cause so strongly that he was willing to stand up for it, and he persevered through many failures, and because he believed in that vision, I think that's remarkable. He persevered, and other labor activists as well pressed on when times were difficult. But by 1863, George moved from the interior of Austin. Out of the brand and being called the goal of that league was to get this awful work day down to a reasonable 8 hours. And we're already getting down to 10, but still it was a long day, so they were both at 8 hours. Boston, but all around the country this was happening. It was an organic effort to bring the work day down to 8 hours. And George served as their president from 1869 to 1874. He was an organizer. He knew how to organize, and he knew how to gain consensus. And that was his gift. He was a powerful orator, he was a good writer, he was not particularly educated. Was he, Roger?
No, just after he left Amesbury, then he just went to work in Boston.
Yeah, so he wasn't. So no formal education, but he was remarkable what he was able to accomplish.
He was a shoemaker by trade. Moved to Boston and became a publisher.
He recognized the power of the press, as Roger just alluded. He edited labor publications in New York, Fall River, Paterson, New Jersey, and Roger will elaborate on that a bit. He helped to win several state and federal 8-hour laws. And the sad thing is, though, that even though the laws were passed, they were rarely enforced. Employers, surprisingly, found ways to get around them. But together with fellow reformer and abolitionist Wendell Phillips, who I don't know, treasure research, he lobbied the Massachusetts legislature to establish the Bureau of Labor Statistics in 1869. Now, that was significant because no one had been collecting any data on this at all. No data about how many kids were working, how many hours they were working, how many adults, what their hours were, all that stuff wasn't being tracked at the time. So George was appointed co-director. So he was a labor pioneer. Himself to perform detailed analyses of this data that he was now gathering. And once he had that data, he could provide very clear evidence of labor abuse in the mills. It went from being what I think and probably to this fact, this happened. Under his leadership, the Bureau published one of the nation's first studies on the conditions of working people. So Massachusetts was at the forefront of all this. Among those research papers, they proved that over 25,000 kids were working in mills. So just wrap your head around it, 25,000 kids were trapped in these mills. And these weren't just a couple of workplaces like this. These were huge buildings with giant windows to let in as much ambient as possible. They were nailed shut because today, the ideal day in the mill, because it's humid, the fibers stick together better, it's ideal. Miserable to work in. And that's the life they lived. Aside, if you ever get to see the video, the workers remember from the World Museum, I don't know if you've seen that. It's a remarkable video of the last generation of people who worked in the mills. Their actual accounts of what it was like to work in the mills. It's called The Workers Remember. It's amazing. I use snippets of that that are not too graphic for my fourth graders to let them hear what it's like to be in the mills, what it's like to work there. Anyway. Was so concerned that growing up, the kids didn't have any or but the slightest knowledge or rudiments of education. And as a result of his Bureau's work, in 1874, the legislature passed laws limiting children and women working in a factory for 10-hour days. Not his 8-hour goal yet, but he was getting there. Later, he was given the job of monitoring the factory owners to make sure they were providing schooling for these kids, 10 to 15-year-olds. He found countless violations. This is my favorite quote of this. "Feed the little ones," he wrote in 1875. "Ignorance and poverty are twin monsters. And education is a means of moving them both. We must work for universal education." So at this around the same time, the garment workers in Philadelphia had formed Knights of Labor in 1869, and they adopted almost word for word George's language of the Constitution. So he was not fully educated. Wrote a document that they adopted almost word for word. He joined the Knights and became treasurer of them in the District of Greenwich, Massachusetts, as the state's largest labor organization. They had, I think, 700,000 members across the nation. They preferred arbitration over strikes. They wanted to be nonviolent. They wanted to achieve their goals without violence. teach K to four, but in fourth grade, I used George as the vehicle for teaching these kids civics. So we talk about how kids are so fortunate today, they take something for granted. When you and I take for granted, turning the tap and drinking water. But they take for granted, they actually get to go to school today. They actually get together. And the breaks, the recesses, the lunches, all those things that these poor kids didn't. And I used the photographs of a famous photographer, Lewis Hine, one of the oldest work. If you have it, it's worth Googling. He took countless number of photographs of industry at that time, turn of the century, the 1904 around there. But his photos I used of Lewis where he went into the mills and purposely documented kids working. And he's got photos of kids as young as 6 years old in the mills. The mill owners loved the kids because they had tiny hands and little fingers that get into the machinery.
Teachers decide who the children, boy, girl, and it doesn't make any difference. And have the leadership skills and we give them the award to George E. McNeill Award. So that's sort of where George, as a family name, we know who George was, okay, but this is where it really started with us and the people at. At the same time, we got a process of writing a book, a pamphlet here, just sort of outlining a few of the things that George had done. George, when he left Boston, left Amesbury, was a busy man. I don't know how he ever did all the things he did, but he besides the 8-hour work law and also writing the principles of the Knights of Labor, which was, again became the AFL, he did, as Bruce reported to, he edited 6 newspapers, the New York Labor Standard, the Fall River Labor Standard, the Patterson Labor Standard, the Patterson Home Journal, among others. He also is the author of a book that's still being published and used in labor courses in the United States, the history of the labor movement of 1886. And so he was busy doing that, but at the same time, he traveled around the world. He was the AFL representative going to London to speak. He spoke in Washington at the Washington Monument for over 13,000 people. He spoke in Chicago. He just traveled, wrote books, and just kept moving. And one of his whole goal was organize. It was his theme. And the other thing with the 8-hour work law was 8 hours for work, 8 hours for rest, and 8 hours for anything that you want to do for yourself. And those were the things that he stood by. Another thing he did, he was concerned about injuries that happened in the mills, but particularly was for some reason he got interested in the railroads, where the person that was working on the railroads got hurt and lost an arm and wouldn't receive any money. So he started the first disability insurance company in the United States in 1883, the Massachusetts Mutual Association. And what it was an association where people who were in the railroad industry would give $5 and we'd have this pot. Then Bruce would have an accident. So they'd take money out of this pot and help pay groceries, whatever the man needed. And then when the fund got low, they had what they call a call. They'd go to the members again and say, we need some more money for the pot because somebody else could get hurt. So he started the accident business in the United States and then subsequently it became a regular insurance company for many, many years. When George died in 1906, the AFL-CIO put a monument up to him for him, which is in Forest Hill Cemetery. And Samuel Bacchus was the keynote speaker. Honey Fitz, Rose Kennedy's grandfather, father, was also a speaker. And what, let's give my book here a second. And I think what Samuel Bacchus said in his eulogy, which is not too long right here, pretty much describes what he thought. He was a mentor to Samuel Bacchus. They were very, very close friends. Sam relied on him, counseled him, used him for counseling. He was a mentor for him. He did so many more things before Sam really got going. But anyway, Samuel Bacchus said, I doubt there is a character and makeup of any man, a higher conception of duty and a deeper love of his fellow, a more kindly disposition, loving character, and brave mind than was possessed by the man whose honor we meet today. George E. McNeill and that other great mental giant gone before, Irish Stewart, gave to the world not only an 8-hour work law, not the 8-hour moment, but something far greater and better. The sound philosophy upon which that movement is based. It is the philosophy of a man's greater needs, a man of greater hope, man's greater hope, and man's greater aspiration for the cultivation of its best that it can be in man. And no one more eloquently or forcefully than George pressed that claim upon the minds of our fellow workers and thinkers of all walks of life, upon the callous consciousness of our opponents. Not until man is regarded as a token of a barbaric age will the life and work of George McNeill be fully appreciated. And that's the eulogy of the game. And it's coming right. So that's sort of the life. There is one other thing that's kind of cute here that George did. He
International Association of Health Underwriters, which was a national organization in the United States and Canada, decided after George's death that they wanted to give a medal for bravery for people. And they gave it out from 1907 to 19, just beginning of World War I. An example of the people who won this award for bravery, one fellow was Ivan Kevorkian from Buffalo, New York, who jumped off Niagara Falls and saved the lady who was drowning. So he was a 19-year-old. Another individual that won the George E. McNeill Award was a gold medal about this big by Tiffany's. And I found one with the man who would be borrowed, but they all forgot the story during World War I and World War II. The Tiffany's were talking medals. But the other one that I thought was kind of cute was George Sanborn, who was from San Francisco. He was taking the ferry boat from San Francisco to Sausalito. And his mother had a baby carriage on the ferry. And the ferry carriage takes off and goes into the water. And so this George Sanborn jumped in the water, saved the baby and the carriage, and he won the medal. So in addition to all the other things he did, he did a lot of good deeds and a lot of people benefited from it. That's about it.
Discover how we became who we are. I love the fact that Amesbury's carriage industry
shops that were still there welcomed the craftsmen in, the companies into their buildings to continue operations as they rebuilt. So, this, every town has fascinating history. I really do, because the more I dig into this, see that, that seed of innovation that I spoke to earlier really was in Amesbury, and yes, it came full circle when and the engineering get better and better and better, and Amesbury profited from that in the height of this mill era. The Amesbury Character Museum has also brought an artist in, took some old maps, and then redrew them in a way that had the same formatting, so you can actually view the mill's mill area of the 1600s, and then overlay and view the same area over time to see how they brought the water, how they had canals, how many dams were in place to water. It's neat to see that change over time to the point where all of a sudden the water car wasn't sufficient. The town tried to make the most of it. They built a huge granite dam across the Powell, as it stands today, using granite from the Rockport quarries that impounds what's now known as the garden. And that's millions of gallons of water that at its peak provided a great amount of energy. But eventually the idea of steam power took over and the legacy of water pipes was still there. There are steam pipes to the marks. So there are those tools on there. And it's been interesting to dig back in Amesbury's history and see how the mill has evolved as the marks has been evolved over time. One of the mills was they made knife twists of the war, then they did other kinds of fabric, and then they were in the ice box industry, after the carriage industry. One failing operation, they thought they were cutting edge, they had characters called, they didn't realize characters anymore. They had ice boxes, it's not ice boxes anymore. So they kept